By what name are you known?
There are some who call me... Tim?
Welcome to another episode of Timmy Talks, the channel where we talk old school magic. And today we are in Vienna, Austria for the Viennageddon tournament. And I'm really looking forward to this. This is the biggest old school magic tournament of Austria. And I was invited here. I streamed from here. And now, of course, I'm going to make episodes out of this fantastic tournament. 39 players here at the start. And from this point forward, every single week, I'm going to show you a match played at this tournament all the way up to the final. So here you can follow all the ins and outs of this great event. And in this round, we see a match played in the Swiss. I believe it's a third round match between Martin and Oliver. Both of these decks are doing very well. I think they've got 2 wins and 0 losses. We have Martin, who's on blue-white control flyers, a very controlling deck. But his opponent is Oliver, and he is also playing a very controlling brew, a completely different strategy, I guess, but also a control brew. He's playing Disco Troll. So we've got Nevinyrral's Discs and Sedge Trolls in this one. And of course, both players are playing with a lot of power, but more about that later in this video when we are going to start talking about the deck decks. But before I do that, before I dive into the decks, first a message from our sponsor, 341 Trading. 341 Trading is one of Europe's leading Magic the Gathering retailers. Their online shop has a fantastic selection of high-end Magic cards, especially for vintage, legacy, and yes, yes, old school Magic players. They now exclusively offer my community free, fully insured, and fast worldwide shipping on all their high-end singles, full sets, and out-of-print sealed products. They upload new cards every Wednesday and have weekly sale offers and reductions waiting just for you. Use my code TIMMY to get free worldwide shipping on your first order over $500 or euros. Have fun ordering those cards, and thank you 341 Trading for sponsoring this video. We are back and ready to dive into those deck decks. Let's start with the deck of Martin Blue White Flyers. Here we go. And here we see the deck of Martin. So, I mean, as you can see, this is really like a classical blue-white control build, right? And I've called it blue-white flyers because, of course, he's only playing with flying creatures. He's got Sarah Angels in here, one beautiful air elemental, and one super cool phantom monster. I love, Martin, the fact that you've put one phantom monster in. Let me know in the comments below if there is a special reason for that. Obviously, it is a 3-3 flyer for 4. You don't see it that often. I mean, you could also go perhaps for a ghost ship here, which is my personal favorite for a 4-drop when I'm talking about blue flyers. Then again, of course, the Phantom Monster is easier to splash with the 1 blue and 3. Another option could be a Surrender Befreed, but that's a more aggressive deck, and you're, of course, playing a more control game. And we've got that classical combination, of course, between Moat and Sarah Angel, right? You can see the Moat right next to it. And Moat is one of those key enchantments, 2 white and 2 to cast, that says non-flying creatures cannot attack. So that means that you don't have to worry about those non-flyers. That also means, of course, that you do take out your own Mishra's Factories. But hey, you're the person in control of the Moat. You decide when to play it and when it's the best moment to use it. And I'm mentioning those Mishra's Factories for a reason, because I think that's a really good tech against, for example, the Nevinyrral's Discs here of his opponent. Now, when we're looking at the rest of the deck, of course, we're going to see GMD Tomes, because when you play control, you want to have some card draw. And it's really nice to kind of, you know, sit back, watch your opponent try to figure it all out, counter some stuff away, and in the end step, just draw a card with your GMD Tome. I mean, that's kind of what you want to do with this deck. When we're looking at the counter magic here, we see counter spells, mana drain, and also one power sink. And I really like that. I like the fact that Martin has put a lot of like one-offs in the deck. So one Phantom, one Air Elemental, one power sink, one Boomerang. Boomerang, super versatile card, one control magic. They're cards that can be very impactful, but in a way, they're kind of better as a one-off. Also, one city in a bottle. I'm really liking that vibe, because it's also harder for your opponent to kind of play against those cards. For example, if you see a power sink in your first game, it gets into your head. You keep thinking, like, how many power sinks does he play? Maybe he's going to play a power sink as well. The same kind of goes for Boomerang. If you Boomerang something, control magic, the same story. So if you happen to hit that game one, and I think that's kind of what you want to do, and use it really well, then you get into the head of your opponent, and I think that's quite good. Now, of course, besides these cards, we see, like, the regular white control package, right? I mean, white It is just an annoyingly good color. We've got Swords to Plowshares, we've got Disenchant, and of course we've got Balance, the best card to get you back into a game when you're behind. But for me, the focus is really on when I look at what can do white really well, my main focus goes to the Disenchant. The fact that you can destroy an enchantment or an artifact at instant speed just for 2 mana, only 1 white and 1, you don't really have to dig that deep into your white mana pool, that is just insane. You know, I think it's the best common in old school Magic. You know, let me know in the comments below if you have a different favorite. I know Lightning Bolt is also fantastic, but for me, also because when I compare what Disenchant can do and then compare to other colors, like, you don't have a card that can destroy two different targets, two different type of cards in one card. Yes, you've got a Fissure, of course, but that's, you know, a way higher casting cost. Anyway, I'm getting a little bit off topic here. I'm babbling about Disenchant all of a sudden, but I just think it's such a good card. And yes, you see it all the time, but that doesn't make it less good. As a matter of fact, that shows how good it is. So this is the deck of Martin here. Super good, super controlling, very classical build, and it's going to be tough for Oliver to actually play against him here. Talking about that, let's take a look at the deck of Oliver. And here we see the deck of Oliver. So this is a Troll Disco deck with a lot of burns. So maybe first focus on that Troll Disco part. So for a good Troll Disco, you need trolls. We've got 4 Sedge Trolls, a creature from the core expansion, 1 red and 2 to cast for a 2/2. And when you play a swamp or when you control a swamp, it gets +1/+1. So it's basically a 3/3 because if you have the right duels, which are of course in this deck, you will almost always have a 3/3 creature for 3. And then we're not even done yet because it also has regeneration for 1 black. And that's quite important because you want to combine this card with Nevinyrral's Disc. And Nevinyrral's Disc is an artifact for 4 that comes into play tapped. When it untaps, you can pay 1 and tap it. And then it destroys all artifacts, creatures, and enchantments. And destroys means that you can regenerate your creatures, so you can regenerate your Sedge. And then, of course, you've destroyed the creatures of your opponent and you can start attacking. Nice to note here is that the disc does not destroy lands. So if you have your Mishra's Factory as a land on the battlefield, you can wait till after your disc resolves, then animate your factories and start attacking your opponent as well. So those creatures also work together really well with the Nevinyrral's Disc. You also see builds where players combine this card with a Rook Egg. We don't have a Rook Egg in here. I guess this is a bit more of a serious Troll Disco build, because here we see 4 Lightning Bolts, 4 Psionic Blasts, so that's a lot of direct damage, and also a Red Elemental Blast main. And I think that Red Elemental Blast main is a very good meta call. I mean, almost everybody here is playing blue power, so why not have that Red Elemental Blast ready to kind of counter that Ancestral Recall? Another inclusion could have been, but you got to make choice, of course, building these decks, could have been the Fork. I recently played against a Red Mage who was playing, I believe, 3 Forks, and they were good. They were really, really good. He did some really funny stuff with it. And it was really good to see. Like, Fork copies all those restricted cards, all those blue power cards. It's really good. It also copies the counterspell to counter the counterspell. It's just really, really good. Talking about counterspells, we also see 4 counterspells in here and a mana drain. It's just a really controlling deck. And just to get kind of back to that burn, 4 Psionic Blasts means 16 direct damage power in there, combined with your Lightning Bolts means another 12 points. So 28 points of direct damage are in this deck. That is huge. If you can just deal a little bit of damage with, you know, the trolls and the factories, maybe get him to 10, it's really easy for him to finish it off with burn. Also because he's got he's got both of the draw 7s in the deck. So, I mean, he's got Wheel of Fortune and Time Twister. So that's going to help him dig for more direct damage. And then when we're looking at the rest of the deck, one thing that I notice here as well is the 3 Mazes of If main. So 3 Maze of If main. So it's super defensive. And when we remember the deck of Martin, that deck is also very controlling, very defensive. So we've got 2 decks with a lot of solutions, a lot of counter spells. We've got 2 decks that are really good at not taking any damage. So, I mean, we could be in for a long sit for a real nail biter, or maybe we just need to drink a couple of beers. I don't know. I guess the only way to find out is by going to the actual match. So again, we've got Martin, Blue White Flyers against this deck of Oliver, Troll Disco. Here we go. Game number 1, here we go. So it's 0-0. Martin on the left here with his Blue White Flyers deck. Oliver on the right taking a mulligan going down to 6. He's on Troll Disco, playing Troll Disco in his version with a lot of burn, 4 Psionic Blasts and 4 Bolts. Ooh, look at this opening here. Sapphire there as well means counter magic is up here for Oliver. He's also playing with four counter spells and a mana drain. Then we see Martin here playing City of Brass, passing the turn. So remember, both of these decks are quite controlling. So we could be in for a kind of a long match, a long build-up. Both players just playing lands here, passing turns. Those factories could get interesting later in the game. It's just waiting here for the first player to actually cast something. There's the Badlands and the pass. Let's see what Martin can do. There's another Tundra for him. It looks like he's got at least one counter spell in hand. It's kind of hard to identify the rest. And Oliver having, I believe, a Shatter there. Looks like he's going to cast something, tapping two. What are we going to see? Oh, Chaos Orb there. Yep, Chaos Orb hitting the board. Are we going to see a response? Are we going to see the counter spell being used? Now remember, Martin, of course, is playing with Disenchant as well. So maybe he can just wait for the activation, then Disenchant. Another factory. There's another Chaos Orb. Okay, Chaos Orb of Martin also on the board. Are we going to see a counterspell here by Oliver? No, we are not. He's just taking on his turn. I was kind of expecting counter magic there. Perhaps he doesn't have it. Or he doesn't care. Ooh, Ancestral Recall. There's the counterspell though by Martin. No counterspell back. So I guess you can conclude here that Oliver doesn't have a counterspell in hand. Or else I'm sure he would have protected his Ancestral Recall. Now remember, he is also playing with one red Elemental Blast main. So curious to see if we see that card in action. Ooh, Library of Alexandria. How many cards does Martin have? I believe I count four there in total. So Oliver has some time, but just passing the turn here. Really needed to resolve that Ancestral to find some more lands. And now we see Martin getting a little bit aggressive here, animating the factory. Are we going to see, there's a Shatter, I believe. Yep, that's a Shatter here. Is he going to protect it with counter magic? Nope, he's not. It's just a one-for-one trade, so I think this is a good decision by Martin. Even if you have counter magic, to just let this be. There's a pass. And he's going to go up, I believe, six in hand now. So if you're Oliver, you have to start doing something. Found a City of Brass there. Taking it back, though. But now, of course, your opponent knows about that city. I mean, all information is kind of useful. Tapping two. There's a Demonic Tutor. Are we now going to see counter magic? Yep, there's the counter spell. Because, I mean, if you don't, your opponent is probably going to look up a strip mine and strip away the Library of Alexandria. And that's, of course, why he took that land back. Realizing that, you know, if you already have a land drop, the strip mine plan is not going to work. You have to wait an entire turn. And now we've got seven cards, right? Or is it six? I guess it's just six. See Martin kind of thinking there, putting his hands together. I see a lot of Swords to Plowshares in there, perhaps also. Is that a Sarah Angel? I think I saw a Sarah Angel in two Swords, but I could be wrong. So six cards, I believe, for Martin. And perhaps Martin is passing the turn. And yeah, now it's Oliver's turn. I believe there's a Sedge troll. He's thinking about playing it out. There goes, there is the Sedge. And I think you kind of have to, you know, you have to start putting some pressure on Martin with that Loa that's about to be active. Tapping two more. There's a Time Walk. Okay. Does it resolve? It does. Okay, it's taking a damage. Writing it on the notepad, not on his dice. So maybe it's going to be tricky to track life here. There's the attack for three. He's going to drop to 17. Thank you, Martin, for tracking on your dice. That's helpful for the viewers and for me. Ah, there we go. So now he's on 19. He has attacked here with the Sedge. And I mean, that Sedge can stick. And I thought he had... Oh yeah, of course, he doesn't want to play the Swords yet. First, I want to go up to 7. Because I want to say, I thought he had the Swords Supply Chest in hand. But of course, once you go up to 7, draw card number 8. And now probably he's going to Swords the Sedge. Or does he have better options? There's the tap. And yep, there's the Swords to Plowshares. Is he going to defend it though? No, he's not. Swords down. He does gain three more lives. So he's going to go up to 22. But this is one of those matches that's all about control. Life totals don't really say anything. They buy you some time, I guess. But this is all about the control. Underground Sea hitting the board. Passing the turn. And both players just being really patient with those Chaos Orbs. It's really a standoff. And I mean, this is great for Martin. Martin is fine with this situation. He's got the active Loa. And I mean, Oliver is really the player that has to start trying to do something against it. And that's going to be harder and harder the more cards Martin draws, because I mean, at a certain point, his hand will be filled with counter magic. Here we see the Demonic Tutor. Again, no counterspell. I really think that Lucas simply does, or sorry, Oliver simply doesn't have counter magic at the moment. And Martin here has looked up the card, shuffling up again. Now I wonder what it is. I mean, he doesn't need Ancestral Recall. He doesn't play with Mind Twist, I believe, or does he? Don't think he does, but anyway, we'll find out soon enough. There's a Volcanic Island. Yeah, just a lot of discs there, and they're just not looking very good against this board. The only thing that happens when you disc, I mean, I guess you could disc. There's a recall. So playing a recall, I believe, for two here. There's a counterspell, though. Going to counter the recall. And what I wanted to say is with the disc, I mean, you could play the disc, comes into play tapped. Then kind of, you know, force your opponent, in this case Martin, to kind of use that Chaos Orb on the disc or on the other Chaos Orb. And at least that's something you're kind of cleaning up. And then in response, of course, you can use your Chaos Orb and then you can flip it on the Loa. So that could be a line. Here's a Sarah Angel, okay. So we're getting some life here to the party. Sarah Angel hitting the board, 4/4 flying. That, of course, doesn't have to tap when she attacks one of the best creatures in old school. And therefore, also one that you see the most. I guess Sarah Angel, Serenity Befreed, Savannah Lion, Triskelion, these are all creatures that you see a lot. Hypnotic Spectre, of course. Sedge Troll is also probably in that list. There's a Nevinyrral's Disc hitting the board. Yeah, now the disc kind of has some weight to it with that Angel. There's a tap. There's an Ancestral Recall. Oh, man. So many riches here for Martin. So much card advantage. And if you're Oliver, you've got to be really, really worried at this stage. It seems to be just a matter of time until Martin will finally win this. I mean, Martin does have a pretty slow deck. Very, very controlling. But I mean, he does have, I believe, 4 Sarah Angels, Air Elemental, Phantom Monster. So could start using that. There's the attack. So some damage here for Oliver. Going to drop to 18. Counting cards in hand. Probably 7. Going to draw a card from the Loa. Going to go up to 8. Tapping 2. What are we going to see here? There's a Time Walk. Okay, wow. Taking another turn. Can attack again then with that Sarah. Could put Oliver here on 14. Could, of course, also consider to start attacking with his Mishra's Factory as well. Going to tap 2 more Disenchant here on the disc. I mean, I think you just have to accept it, right? What can you do? Especially if you don't have a counterspell. What would have been nice here if you would play Fork is then Fork the Disenchant, try to take out his Chaos Orb. But it's not in his deck. There's the attack with the Sarah. So Oliver dropping to 14. And that Sarah now has dealt 8 points of damage. Quite nice. I believe in the hand there we also see a Brain Geyser. Wow. He's already got so many cards. Also has a Brain Geyser. I think I would have considered here, by the way, to also attack with the Factory. Of course, I don't really know all the things that are in his hand. Maybe he wants to keep the mana. Going to draw card number 8 here. Wow. Oh, man. I mean, that Loa is getting out of hand. Oliver really needs a Strip Mine. And, okay, there we see a recall. So a recall for 1, I believe. He's probably going to get back the Time Walk, right? He could Time Walk again. I'm a little surprised that he doesn't... Okay, he's going to go for a counterspell. I'm a little surprised he doesn't want to recall for 2, perhaps. You know, then also get the Time Walk back. Or 3, maybe. You know, you get Time Walk, Ancestral Recall, and maybe a counterspell. But he's just going to go for this counterspell, discarding a land from his hand. So he's playing super safe, but it looks like Oliver may want to respond to this. Okay, let's see what he does. There's a Psionic Blast on the Angel before he gets back the counterspell. So in response to him casting the recall or not, or is it on the life total? No, it's on the Angel. Okay, so the Angel dies. Now he gets back the counterspell. Okay, that's pretty good. I didn't expect that to resolve. Actually, I thought there was some counter magic in hand for Martin, but I guess he didn't. And now Oliver can finally take on his turn. He's on 11, after taking, of course, 2 damage from his own Psionic Blast. So it's now 11 against 17, but the biggest problem for Oliver here is that active Library of Alexandria. It's going to tap 4. There's another Nevinyrral's Disc. I mean, why not just keep playing him out? He's got counter magic now in hand, by the way. I believe I saw a counter spell. Ooh, he's going to counter this. I'm a little surprised, to be honest, that he's countering this. Because, I mean, you only have that Chaos Orb there. I mean, I guess you want to protect your Loa. Anyway, Martin here drawing another card. I believe he's back up to 7. Going to draw card number 8. There's another factory. Attacking now. Yeah, getting a little bit more aggressive. I think you kind of need to. There's a bolt, though. I guess it's going to work. Yep. Bolting the factory. Now remember, Oliver is playing with 4 bolts also. So 4 bolts and 4 Psionic Blasts. Passing the turn here. Back to Martin. And I mean, for Martin, this still looks great. I mean, he's drawing an extra card every single turn. I can tell from experience, or by experience, I should say, that playing against an active Loa is horrible. And if you're playing with an active Loa yourself, you know that you basically have to win the game, right? I mean, if you lose, you're making mistakes. So it also puts some pressure on you in some kind of weird way. But of course, it's also nice. It's really nice because you're drawing more cards than your opponent. Whoa, look at this counter battle. Lightning Bolt, counterspell on the bolt, another counterspell on the counterspell, trying to protect this factory. But it's hasta la vista, baby. At the end of the road, the factory gets roasted. But I think if you're Martin, you can just be patient. I mean, look at that. He's got a grip full of cards. Oliver now has 2 cards in hand. Was that another counterspell in the hand of Oliver, by the way? Or am I just making things up here? Now he's going to flip. He's going to give it a try in response. He's going to flip in response a Shatter. Are we going to see a Shatter? There's a Shatter. And he has a counterspell. It actually works. Doesn't even need the counterspell. So the other card in hand for Oliver is another counterspell. Yep, that's a hit. This was an important flip. He did it very quickly, very nonchalant, but... Did I say that correctly? Nonchalant? Nonchalant? I don't know. I don't know how to pronounce that stuff. Anyway, he did it as if it didn't take him a sweat, but he did hit that Chaos Orb very, very well. Or sorry, that Library of Alexandria very, very well with his Chaos Orb. But this was a really good flip. And I mean, Oliver is still behind, but he's getting... Well, actually, he's very far behind still because we still have that Brain Geyser in Martin's hand. But remember that one card in the hand of Oliver is a counterspell. And I mean, I think if you're Martin, you're probably not going to expect a counterspell. I think he's going to go for it. I think he's going to sack the Lotus. He's going to play a huge Brain Geyser. Oh, this is big. Oh, this is big. This is big. No, it's a Fireball. Counterspell on the Fireball. Oh, man. So what if Martin would have gone here for the Brain Geyser instead of the counterspell? Sorry, for the... Brain Geyser instead of the Fireball. Do you think Oliver would have countered it? I think he would have. Now at least we're going to see a Brain Geyser from Martin. I guess it's going to resolve, although we don't know what that one card now in hand is of Oliver, of course. But this counterspell was very, very important. So we see a Moat, which is useless for now. We see a Swords, which is useless. And now we have a Brain Geyser. Pretty modest one, actually, considering all the mana that he has. A Brain Geyser for 4, I believe. I do see a Sarah now in hand. There is a City of Brass. I guess he has to start discarding or not. Does he have 7? Does he maybe want to play out the Sarah Angel without any protection? I mean, there's only one card in hand for Oliver. He's played out a lot of counter spells already. No, choosing to discard here. So the moat is going to go into the bin. I believe he's got his second moat in hand as well, playing two moats in total in his list. There's the Sarah, 4-4 flyer. Are we going to see a response? Psionic Blast, counter magic. Don't think so. Just two cards for Oliver. And maybe that blue card is a Phantom Monster, the 3-3 flyer. I really hope to see the Phantom in action. There we see the Sedge Troll. And there's the pass. So, I mean, this is why Sarah is so good, right? You attack with it, you fly over the Sedge, deal 4. You don't have to tap it, and you can use it as a blocker the next turn. I mean, Sarah Angel, it's so good. So I believe it's going to drop to 7, if I'm not mistaken, exactly from 11 to 7. Going to tap 4. Are we going to see that Phantom Monster? No, Control Magic. This is that one-off Control Magic in his deck. And this is really tough to deal with if you're playing with the colors that Oliver is playing with. He doesn't have green for Tranquility. He doesn't have white for Disenchant. He does have that red Elemental Blast in his deck. But I mean, you've got to be lucky enough to find it. Already played his Demonic Tutor. Okay, this Mace will buy him a little bit of time. Now remember, Martin also has Swamps. So his Sedge is also a 3-3. So if he attacks with both, he's still going to deal 3 points of damage. So another Sarah in hand here. There's the attack. Going to send back the Sarah, drop to 4. I mean, it's looking bad. There's another Sarah. And of course, the foundation for this game 1 victory for Martin was built with that Loa. I mean, he had that Loa so long. He also resolved an Ancestral Recall, and he resolved a Brain Geyser. So it's no surprise here that Martin takes game number 1. And now both players are going to dive into their sideboards, and we will catch back up with them in game number 2. Game number 2, here we go. So one game up for Martin, the player on the left. That means Oliver's on the plate. Let's see if they both keep. Looks like they do. There's a Volcanic and a pass. And there's a Tundra and a pass. So I think we're going to see pretty much the same as what we saw in game 1, just both players playing their lands, taking it easy. There's a Plains. There's a Mace. So again, you know, getting the Mace up, counter magic up. I mean, this is so defensive. There's your Factory and a pass. I mean, at least Martin doesn't have double blue, so there are some openings. Oh, missing a land drop here. That's bad here for Oliver. Because, I mean, now you've got some openings. He doesn't have counter magic up yet. You could start, you know, playing some stuff out. Get your Sedge on the board, and yes, and still can get swords, but at least you can do something. But missing your land drops, oh, discarding a card, you never know, disc hitting the bin. Yeah, this is tough. There's a scrub land. I wonder if he's gonna animate. I mean, do you really want to? You know, your opponent is playing with bolts, probably 4, right? So, do you want to run into a bolt at this stage? Looks like he's thinking about casting something. He's probably not going to animate the factories here. Tapping 4. Are we going to see that moat perhaps hitting the board? The question is, why would you? No, we're going to see a book. That makes more sense. Gem de Tome. Are we going to see a shatter? Nope, a counterspell. So a line you could have followed to say, I'm first going to play up my moat to kind of lure out a counterspell and then do the book. The next turn, I mean, it's pretty slow, but you could have done that. Again, then you have no guarantees. Maybe he's got a counterspell and a shatter, or maybe 2 counterspells. I mean, his hand is full. Ooh, look at that. He is going to attack here, it seems. Going to animate bow. Nope. For a moment there, I thought he wanted to pick it up, put it into the red zone. Oh, Phantom Monster time. Yeah, 3-3 flying. There's a red Elemental Blast, though. This is, yeah, protected, baby. Blue Elemental Blast. The fight over the Phantom Monster. Only here at Viennageddon. We're in the Long Hole pub, by the way. Really nice bar. But yeah, this is pretty epic. Ah, not a red Elemental Blast. It wasn't meant to be, but I'm just happy to have seen the Phantom Monster here getting played. It's a one-off in the deck of Martin. Very cool creature. Really nice flavor text. Really a classic creature. There's a Soul Ring. That's not going to do much. I guess it's going to do something. It's going to animate both of the factories here. It's going to put them into the red zone. And this is the nice thing. You send it back, then he can pump it, so still deal 3 damage. So Mace is just not great against multiple factories. And now we've got one city still untapped, so I guess Oliver doesn't have lightning bolts. And here we see a time walk. So that's going to give him that extra turn. And now he can deal 4 damage. He could put Oliver here on 12. That's exactly what happens. So Oliver dropping to 12. Are we going to see another follow-up? We see a balancing hand there. Could be interesting later, you know, to try to kind of use that as a mind twist. Doesn't mean you're going to lose a lot of lands, though. There's a Badlands being played by Oliver, finally finding some lands for him. Now is enough mana to, for example, cast a Sedge. Attacking with both again, sending one back, so taking 3, dropping to 9. Exactly, so it's kind of going quickly now for Oliver. Has to be careful. Really has to start playing out something. Okay, there's a Shatter on end step. So taking care of one of the threats, which basically is enough because you've got that Mace for the other one. Ooh, there's a Bolt in hand now as well. I believe he also has a Chaos Orb in hand. And I think it's clever that he waits with the Chaos Orb. You know, I think ideally you want to play it and use it in the same turn because you're giving your opponent information, of course. But it is hard to use a Chaos Orb against a deck that plays white and counter magic. Because you got to worry about the counterspell, you got to worry about the disenchanting response. It's just very difficult. Tapping 5. Are we going to see a Sarah Angel here? No, we're going to see a recall. So recall for 2, I guess. What is he going to get back? Time Walk and Counterspell? No, he's going to get back Mishra's Factory and Time Walk. There's a Counterspell, though. One more point of damage, though. It's going to drop to 8. There's another Factory. Okay, so next turn he can start attacking again. I mean, Oliver is still in trouble here. There's a Black Lotus. I mean, is this Lotus what the Doctor ordered? Can he now, for example, cast a Nevinyrral's Disc? Doesn't look like he has it there in hand. Does have a Terror, I believe. Maybe he boarded extra in after seeing all those Sarah Angels. Ooh, there's a Brain Geyser. This needs to resolve. Will it resolve? Brain Geyser for 4? Yes, it will. So this is really important here for Oliver. Needs to find lands. Oh, look at that. A Library of Alexandria. Oh, this is huge. 7 in hand, I believe, passing the turn. So it can start using the Loa. This is huge. So game 1, we saw Martin eventually winning it because of the Loa. And now we see Oliver with the Loa, but he's under a lot more pressure. So that's a difference. Animating both factories here, I assume. Or not. Oh, he's going to go for a balance. Of course, he still had that balance in hand. I forgot all about it, to be honest. And now both players are going to look at the lands, cards in hand, and creatures, but there are no creatures in play. So we see Martin losing just one land, it seems. So that's very, very doable, both players having 5 lands. But more importantly here, Oliver will have to discard, and that's such a pity for him. He had that counterspell in hand. I believe he's got a time walk in hand. He's going to lose so many cards. Going to keep the Time Walk, I believe, and the Counterspell. Oh, this is so tough for Oliver. Also has to think about defense because he's on 7. He's probably going to drop to 5 this turn, or 4 actually, after the attack of Martin. Because remember, this is played in his first main. Look at that, throwing away a Time Walk. Yeah, you got to do what you got to do. What is he going to keep there? It was hard to see. Chaos Orb also gone. There's the attack, exactly, dropping to 4. Oh man, he's so close. There's Ancestral Recall making matters even worse. But remember, it's really tough for Martin to close. He is playing with that one-off Fireball, but doesn't have any red mana at the moment. Also doesn't have the card in hand, by the way. So let's see what Oliver can do with his turn. Just plays an Underground Sea and passes. Ooh, almost showed the cards there while flicking through his hand. I believe he's got a Lightning Bolt there. I mean, I think if you're Martin, animate attack, right? If he has it, he has it. 3 cards in hand. Sending one back. Going to pump it up. And now we're probably going to see a Bolt. There's the bolt. Are we going to see counter magic? No, we're not. I believe Oliver also has another counter spell in hand, by the way. I mean, if you look at Oliver's list, he's quite good at not dying. The same thing can be said for Martin. So both of these players have a very controlling deck. There's the Sarah. We're probably going to see counterspell. Exactly. There's the counter. We're not done yet. Oliver is clinging on. He just doesn't want to die. There's another Mishra's Factory. He's on four, passing the turn. One card in hand. Two cards in hand for Martin. Three after the draw. Or is it four in hand? Four in hand. Oh, way more. Five even. Luxury for him. I mean, if you have a creature, play it out, right? Just put more pressure on. Tapping five. Exactly. There's another creature. Sarah Angel hitting the board. There's the pass. But now remember, Oliver has that factory. Another factory. So it has the mace for the Sarahs. The factories to block the factories of Martin. Martin needs more action. Needs another flyer. A second Sarah. Or that one of Air Elemental could really help him here. I believe he has that Air Elemental in hand. So is he going to go for it? Is he going to play the Air Elemental here? And will it resolve? Those are the big questions here. There's the Air Elemental. It is going to resolve. Okay, so next turn could... Oh, a second mace. I thought we were done for sure, but no, we are not. And I mean, I don't think Martin has a lot of land destruction. And I guess this is why a lot of these decks just run a one-off Armageddon. That could be a consideration for Martin after this play. I mean, look at those motes in his hand. He's got two motes. They're useless. I'm sure in some matchups they're gold. But at this point, at this stage in the game, at this board state, they're pretty useless. There's another factory pass turn. There's an island and a pass. Wow, both players just top decking here. And I wonder how many angels and other flyers are still in the deck here of Martin. We know that the Phantom Monster is in there and at least one Sarah Angel. Here we see the moat. So the moat also means that you can no longer attack, of course, with your own factories. But he only has one, so I do understand this this decision, I guess. I mean, he could have kept it in hand. There's a Swords passing the turn. I mean, one of the things that, you know, when you're Oliver, that you could do here is just wait and find the right moment to play your Nevinyrral's Disc, which is in his hand. And of course, he still has that Loa. Forgot all about it. So he's going to go up to seven, try to reuse that Library of Alexandria again. Oh, ho, ho. Is Oliver actually going to get back from four? All the way back, maybe winning the second game? That would be very spectacular. Passing the turn. Is he on seven now? Yes, he is, using the Loa. He is totally back into this. That mace really helped him. A third mace here hitting the board. Incredible. These mazes are keeping Oliver alive. He's got the active Loa. I mean, the game is tipping here. There is a Black Lotus. Martin passing. Yeah, and Martin just really, with his build, really went for a control build. Doesn't have a lot of direct damage in his deck. I mean, if he just had a Psionic Blast at the right time, could have taken the victory already, but the tables are slowly turning with that active Loa here for Oliver. Tapping two blue, tapping four. Tapping. He's going to play maybe a Brain Geyser here. Brain Geyser for five. For six. Probably going to look for the Fireball. Brain Geyser for six. Are we going to see Counter Magic? Red Elemental Blast in hand. There's the Red Elemental Blast. I mean, this is really important here for Oliver, of course. And yeah, it looks like he made a little mistake. Should have first drawn a card before he played the blast. But I think Martin said you can take it back. But I think Oliver didn't want to. It's like, my mistake. I'm going to own up to it. And I've made that mistake too. Plenty of times, actually. More than I am willing to admit. Anyway, there's an Underground Sea passing a turn here back to Martin. Martin having a counter spell now in hand as well. Both players playing such controlling brews. And, you know, I think that Oliver is now kind of in the driver's seat. Problem is he's on four and has no way to put pressure on, but got to try to burn Martin out here. That's the thing that he has to do. I don't believe there are any flying creatures in the deck of Oliver, but of course he does have a lot of Nevinyrral discs, so if he can get a disc to stick, he could destroy the moat that way. And now, of course, a demonic being played out by Martin. If you're Martin, what are you going to go for? Are you going to go for Fireball? The thing is, I mean, you don't want to play a Fireball now at this stage in the game without counter backup. You actually want to have double counter backup. Because remember, Oliver has seven cards in hand and an active Loa. So you know if you're just going to look up your Fireball, play it out, it's going to counter it away. And to be honest, when I'm looking at these matches, I think a card that's really underplayed, and I'm finding trouble finding a place for it myself in my deck, is Glasses of Urza. I think Glasses of Urza can be so good in these builds. Because timing is so important. Knowing if something is going to resolve is so incredibly important. So look at that, tapping quite a lot here. What are we going to see? Yep, there's the Mind Twist, so he is playing with the Twist. I think in response here, if Oliver doesn't have a counterspell, which is a pretty big if, then he's probably going to burn Martin here to the ground. He's got a lot of burn in there. So here we see a Bolt first. Then we see another Bolt, so that's six. Also has Psionic Blasts in hand. Could go for the Flyers, though, with the Psionic Blast. Also has a Shatter, so there's a Psionic Blast. Doesn't mean he's going to take two himself, going to drop to two. That is risky. So that's 10 here for Martin. So already 10 points of damage dealt. I think that's it. So there was no counterspell here in hand. Now he could go for the Shatter, I guess, on the Black Lotus. If he's got red mana. Doesn't want to use the City of Brass, of course. I mean, he could, whether you're on two or on one. Does that really matter? And what else could he do? Okay, gonna cast, yeah, because then he does need to take the damage. Gonna cast another Shatter. So he kind of made the same conclusion as me. It doesn't matter whether I'm on two or on one against this specific deck. And there's the pass. I would put that City of Brass far away from my table. Another maze. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? I think if you're Martin, you're like, oh man, I'm never going to get through. The only thing he can do really is just find that one Fireball. Oh man, this is crazy. Again, it's looking really good for Martin, but I mean, look at that hand. I believe Counterspell and lots of Swords to Plowshares and another Moat. And here we see a Wheel. We do see a Counterspell here on the Wheel. Yeah, Martin, of course, worried about, you know, the direct damage of Oliver because he is on 10. So that's a realistic threat that he gets burned out. So cannot let that Wheel resolve here. There's another Sarah Angel hitting the board. Yeah, this is just a crazy board state. Absolutely madness. It is one game up for Martin. You know, maybe if you're Martin, you could think, you know what? We've got 50 minutes in each round. I'm fine with this. As long as I don't die, I'm going to win this 1-0. Drawing a card, passing the turn. Another counterspell in hand for him. There's a Volcanic for Oliver, passing the turn. Another Sarah Angel. Okay, so if he finds, I don't even know. I think there's not even another flyer in his deck. Right? Because I know the Sarah's in the graveyard, the Phantom's in the graveyard. So there's no way for him to push actually through these four mazes of if. Going to go through his hand again. One Disenchant there at it. I mean, they're all cards that are not helpful. All those white answers right now that are usually amazing. Right now, they're worth nothing. They're worth jack bleep. You know what I mean? Like, it's not going to help you here. But again, like I said, Martin's one game up. He's fine. If this ends in a draw, it's fine. Looks like he's thinking about playing something out. There's a Divine Offering on the Mox. Okay. little surprised. I guess you want to keep, why would you want to keep the disenchant over the divine? Because the divine can give you life at a certain point. Trying to think, is there a target that you want to have for your disenchant? Anyway, there's an ancestral recall counterspell here by Martin. Mana drain on that counterspell. Are we going to see another counterspell? So really, counterspell war here. Or is he going to just keep it at this one counterspell? Going to go through his graveyard trying to find out how many counterspells have I played. Not that many, actually. And it looks like it's going to resolve. So three cards here for Oliver. Un, dos, tres. Ein, zwei, drei. There's the Badlands. Passing the turn. Wow. Oh, what a game. What a game. Four Mazes of If dealing with three Serra Angels and an Air Elemental. Insane. And I mean, this is like an ad for Armageddon, right? Why should I play Armageddon? Well, this is why. Then again, I mean, you have to resolve the Armageddon even if you have it. But it's not in the deck here. Discarding Control Magic. Yeah, that's pretty useless. Remember, Oliver also doesn't have any flying creatures in his deck, I believe. Just the four Sedge Trolls and the four Mishra's Factories. That's all there's to it. So he also has a super controlling build with lots of burn. And I have to say, it's looking really good for Oliver, right? Because he's got more burn. And Martin has to wait for that one fireball and then has to try to resolve that one fireball. Which is pretty tough. Look at that. Martin just top decking, putting it in the bin. Top decking, putting it in the bin. This is so funny. Look, putting it in the bin. And Oliver now almost back again on 7. Remember, he still has that Loa. He can start using that Loa again. This is insane. Got a Psionic Blast in hand, but he can't play it because then he dies. I actually think if you're Martin, you should keep those swords in hand, to be honest. I guess you want to keep a dis against that. Oh, look at it. Only two cards. Oliver's going to deck himself. Is that a counterspell on the tutor? Why would you counter that? I would just let it resolve. Oh, you're worried about... I would let it resolve, I think. Ooh, he's going to play Time Twister. Oh, it's going to be countered. And that's going to be countered. Will this resolve? If it resolves, a mana drain here. This is what an insane game. Yeah, I think this is the end of the road, though, here for Oliver. Cannot counter this mana drain. Dealing 3. He's going to drop to 7. Only 2 cards left in Oliver's deck. And that's it. Yeah, Oliver's saying, you got this. You know, if that Time Twister doesn't resolve, I'm going to deck myself eventually. But what a completely insane game. Look at that. These are all the last cards left in the deck. Oh, he had that boomerang. He was waiting for the boomerang to send back the maze and then deal the 4 points of damage. I forgot about the boomerang. So the boomerang was his out. That is so funny. Now, do remember, of course, Martin had a lot of swords to plowshares. So even if Oliver would have been able to almost burn him down to the ground in response, Martin could have swords, for example, his own angel, get 4 more life. So it was really important for Martin to make sure that the Time Twister couldn't resolve, because then Oliver could shuffle everything back in his deck and you're back at square one. So wow, what an incredibly intense control match. And this is just our first match from Viennageddon. So if you've enjoyed this episode, make sure to come back again next week. And if you want to support the show, make sure to like, share, and comment. All these things are free and really help the channel move forward. And of course, hit that subscribe button and become a member of the channel so you don't miss a thing, because I'm going to show you matches all the way up to the finals of this tournament, Viennageddon 2024. For now, thank you very much for watching and see you next time. What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor? What shall we do with the drunken sailor? Early in the morning, way, way up she rises, way, way up she rises, way, way up she rises, early in the morning. Put him in the long boat until he's sober, put him in the long boat until he's sober, put him in the long boat until he's sober. Rises.
Just think it is Somba Kazee.